By the end of this tutorial, you will know exactly how to make calculations inside IntegraMAT with the math functions. So let's just dive right in, then I want to show you a cool example, and then we're going to start from the beginning, and then I'll explain what each of these math functions are for. So this is one of my favorite use cases, so by the end of this tutorial, we'll know exactly how this works. You obviously can also use this for something else, but I just thought it's cool to show an actual practical example of what you could do with this. So what I like to do is I like to update the customer lifetime value of a contact inside my email service provider so that every time when somebody places an order, I increase that number to their customer lifetime value so that I know, this contact spent this amount of money with me. So it works like this. So we get here a notification from Thrivecart like, hey, there is a new order. Then we create a new contact. Then we have a router to split the whole scenario in different paths depending on what kind of order it is. So if it's a refund, they go down here. If it's a subscription payment, they go here. And if it's just a regular order, they go up here. Then we get the current lifetime value. So here in my email service provider, you see, for example, here, Emma Doe, the customer lifetime value right now is 1,000. And then we increase that. And to increase it, we use the math functions. So here you see that we parsed a number, we parsed another number, and then the first number, we then add another number, and then we get our new customer lifetime value. So sounds maybe a little bit techy, but at the end of this tutorial, you will know exactly how this works. So then we go over to a blank scenario, and we're going to start with a set variable module. So here we say set variable. Variable name here. I will just set this to example. And the set variable module is basically just a module where you can set a variable that you can use inside your other modules. But what I'm about to show you, all these math functions you can use in any module inside IntegraMAT. So over here, to get the math functions, you just click in the field where you want to use it. You go up here to this math icon, and then we get the math functions. And here you see we have two variables. So these are like the standard variables. We have pi and we have random. Then we have functions and we have operators. Now let's start with the operators. Those I think are the easiest. So here, if we would want to do 100 and then plus 600, for example, okay, then the result of that is 700. Now, super easy, right? You can also do it, for example, like this, 600 divided by 22. Okay, run this module only. And then you see that the result of that is 27.27, really long number, but like round about 27, right? And then the other ones work the same. So here we have multiply and we have divide. Now then we have this one. Modulus. I have to admit, before I made this tutorial, I never actually heard of this. I had to Google it. So here, modulo operations, or yeah, here, modulus. So what it basically does is it is the remainder after dividing one number by another. So for example, here, the 12-hour time uses modulo 12. So 14 o'clock or 1400 hours becomes 2 o'clock. Because 14 divided by 12 is 1 with a remainder of 2. So if we would actually want to do that, we just say, okay, 14 mod 12, okay? Then we run this module only, and then you see here that we get 2 or then 2 p.m. So I didn't even know that it existed. I've never used this before, but hey, if you need it, then it is there. Now then we have these ones. We have lower than or equal to, we have greater than or equal to. So this basically just gives you a true or false depending on if that number is indeed lower or greater or lower and equal, etc., etc. So here, if we would have 5 and then greater than 2, if we would do that, and then here say run this module only, then we would get back true. Because that is true, right? If this number would be a 1, and then over here, we do this, then it says false. So I have to say, I did not use that for my calculations, but yeah, if you need this, then you now know how to do that. And the other ones work exactly the same, like here, greater than, lower than equal to. So for example, if we would have here 3, and then lower than or equal to 3, then if we do here, run this module only, then now you will see that it says true because 3 is equal to 3, right? So that's how all of these work. And the only exception, or maybe a thing that you should know, is that if we, for example, here would have 100 plus, for example, 400, then that is 500, right? But now if you want to multiply it by something, if you would say, okay, here, I want to multiply this by 2, for example, then this is not going to work. We'll also here show you why. So here, run as module only. So it calculated it, but you see that the result is 900. Well, 2 times 500 is 1,000, right? So what it basically did, it did 500, or like here 400, and then it multiplied it by 2 is 800, and then it did plus 100. So if you would want to multiply the result of this, you need to enclose it in basically curved brackets. So to do that, we just copy this whole thing, we remove it, we click this, then we go to the general functions, and then you see that we have this expression. So then you see that we get these curved brackets, right? Then I just paste this in between there. And now Integromat knows, okay, this is a group, and then here math. And then if we now say times 2 and click here, run this module only, then you see now that we get 1,000. So just something to keep in mind, right? Now that is that. Those are the operators. Then we have the functions. Now the functions are not too hard to use, but a little bit more complicated. I think the most complicated one is parse number. So let's maybe start with this one. So parse number, what it basically is for is to tell Integromat how a number is structured, because people in different parts of the world, they write numbers differently. So for example, over here in Europe, we write numbers like this. For example here, 120 cents. So this is our decimal separator, is a comma, but I know that in the States, for example, the decimal separator is a dot. Very confusing, I don't know who came up with that, but hey, we have to work with it. So what we have to do is we have to, oh, this is wrong. We have to parse this number. So here we have parse number. So this is our open curved bracket, closed curved bracket. And then here in the middle, we have our semicolon. And then what we need to do here, and it also explains it, if you this hover this, it says number, and then we have to tell it the decimal separator. So in this case, that is a comma. So here we have comma, and then I click OK. And then now run this module only. Then right now you see here that we get the output, and then it says 100.2. So by default, Integromat works with the dot as a decimal separator. So right now, Integromat actually knows how to use this. So if I would say here now, okay, multiply by 2, then here it says, okay, then that is that. Or if I say here plus, right, plus 50 is maybe a better example, because then I can also show you what would happen if you don't do that. So here, then we get now 150, then dot 2. But if you would not use the parse number, so if you would just have this, if you would not parse that number, then you see that we get this. This 100.2050. So that's why you need to parse that number in some cases. Then you also have a format number. I never needed to use this. I'm also not sure what you would use it for. Maybe if you want to have a number and you want to write it in a nice way, maybe inside an email or something, then you can do this. Format number. So then here we have a super long number. And then what we need to do is we have to tell it the amount of decimal points. So how many decimals does that number have? So then I usually would maybe do 2. So 2 decimals. Then we have to tell it, let's see over here, the decimal separator. So I'm using a comma because I'm based in Europe, right? And then the thousand separator in my case is going to be a dot. And then now when I click OK here, run this module only, then you see here that we get this super long number. So it says 8,734,659,823. And then you see here that we have the decimal separator, right? Also here the thousand separator, and then 2 decimals, which in this case is just 0. So that's how you use that one. I've never had to use it, but If you need it, again, you now you know how to use it. Now, then the other ones are much easier, but then you at least know if you ever have like struggles with like parsing a number or that integral doesn't understand a number, you need to use parse number or format number. So now if you want to have the average, then we could really do simply, so we have here average, and then we have 40, then we have the semicolon, then maybe 20, then here 66, 12, 23, and then now it's just going to give us the average of all these numbers. So run this module only, then you see here 32.2. And again, I'm not sure if I already mentioned this, but all these numbers, I'm typing them now, but obviously they can also be variables from other modules, right? So now, then we have this, but so in case you have here maybe then your decimal separator is a comma, you would have to parse this number. So then you have to add parse number, you have to add that in between here so that it knows how to work with that number. Now then we have seal or sealing. So here seal, and what it basically does is rounding up to the nearest integer, so to the barest, biggest full number without any decimals. So here 1.2, then it's rounded up to 2, and 4 stays 4, because here it says it returns the smallest integer greater than or equal to a specified number. So now, maybe I'll show you an example here. So if we would have 6.4, so here then we can, then you'll see immediately how you can use the parse number inside it, right? Then this is our decimal separator, and then seal, and then I paste this again, and then now we see what happens. Run this module only, then you see that it rounded up that number to 7. So that's how you can also use parse number inside a module like that. If you don't need that, again, you can also just 6.4, right? But it should not be a comma. So a dot, Integromat always understands. I think that's the default. But if you use commas as decimal separators, you need to parse the number first. So that is ceiling. Now then we have floor. It's basically the exact opposite. So 1.2 here goes down to 1. 1.9 goes down to 1. 4 stays 4 because it's less than or equal to. Now then we have max, my name. So max basically returns the largest number of a specified array or the largest number among numbers entered individually. So here, if we would have max, I love this function, it's amazing. So we can either just put a bunch of arrays in there, quite techy, but you can also just have, you can either type the numbers, right? You can just do it like this, here. Type the numbers like this, or again, instead of that you type them, you can also use actual variables from previous modules, right? So here, you click OK. Run this module only, and then you see here that the biggest number is 99, so that's the one that is going to give us back. Now then, minus does exactly the opposite. Then we have round, so round is very similar to seal and floor, but this time it's always rounding up to the nearest integer. So here you see that 1.2 is closer to 1 than to 2, so it's rounding down to 1. 1.5 is closer to 2, so it's going to 2. 1.7 is going to 2. 2 is going to 2. Now then you also have sum. And the sum, I have to say, I don't use so often because I like to use the operators better. So here if we have 1 plus 1, that gives us 2, right? But you can also use sum instead. You can say here 1, and then here the semicolon 1. Run this module only, and then you see that we get as a result then 2. So yeah, this is how you use the operators, the functions. And then you also have the variables. So if you need pi in your math, then you can also use that. Random, this gives you a random number between 0 and 1. And it includes 0, so the random number could be 0, but it could not be 1. It also explains that over here. And something really fun you can do with that, and they also explain that over here, is for example, if you would have a chatbot or something like that, and you would want to roll the dice, you want to have a random number from 1 to 6, you can also use math for that. So what you can do here, they also explain here, we can say random, and then times 6, and maybe also do this step by step. So here we have random times 6. So if we do this, then you will see that it's going to give us a very weird number here, 3.939, a very, 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 very long number, right? And then you see that it wants us to floor this, and you now know how to use floor, right? So floor, if we do here floor, so I copied it, and now here I say floor, so then it's going to return the largest integer less than or equal to a specified number. I paste this in between here. So right now, it's going to give us back 3. Now, if I do this again, maybe it gives us a different one. Now it gives us 3 again. Okay, let's try again. Okay, see, now it's going to give us 1. And then what it wants us to do, it's want to add plus 1, because now the random number can only be 0 till 5, because like I explained earlier, if you use random gives you a random number between 0, and it includes 0, and between 1, and it's not including that 1, so it can never be 6 otherwise. So we want to do plus 1, and right now, this number would always be between 1 and 6, including 1 and including 6. So it's a little fun thing that you can do with these native variables in here. And that's basically how you use all the math functions. So now to go back to our example, then I can show you again how that works. And then you can also really see how you can actually use this. So you see over here that I get a webhook, and this webhook is receiving data from, in this case, my card provider, which is Thrive Card. And then we create or update a contact. And then if it was a regular order, so if the event is order success, that's the way how Thrive Card does it, then I'm going to get the CLV, so the customer lifetime value, and then I increase it. So what I want to do over here, I want to show you this contact. I already showed it to you before. So here we have Emma Doe and the customer lifetime value. Let's see what it is right now. So you see here that the customer lifetime value is 1,000. So what we're going to do, click save. I'm going to click here win once, and I'm going to do an order. I say here Amado, and then here somewhere, then postal code, check out, complete order. Click here to continue. So now it's completing the order, takes a second. Then you see that the order was completed, and then this already started here. You see, boom, you got some data. You see, this is the data we got. Here, event, order, success. And then here you see, okay, if you go down here, order, you see that total str here over is like 500. So the total amount of our order is $500. Then here we created or updated a contact. So it did that, it just updated it, because in this case it already existed. Then we continue, and then over here we go to order success. So you see here that the event order success was met. Now this module is still working, it is getting the contact. So here you see it got the contact. So here it found the contact. And then when we go down here to custom fields, then I know that the current number here, 33, so this is custom field ID 33, it's not super user friendly, but that is the customer lifetime field ID. So here you see that it is 1000. And then over here, what we did now is we said, okay, parse the number custom field 33. The decimal separator here is a dot. So you don't really need to do this because this is the default inside IntegroMod. But just as an example, how you could do this if you would maybe also work with commas, right? Then you see that we parsed this number, and then we did plus, and then we parsed the number here of the total order. So here, if you go down here, then you also see that we have here total, here total is true. So here 500. And then it updated this field to, let's say, value 1500. So just a cool use case that I wanted to show you. So yeah, I really hope that this helped you to understand how you can use math inside IntegroMod. I find it really handy for various cases. Sometimes you just want to calculate something. Sometimes you want to get a random number, for example, a little dice game that I just showed you. Or you want to get a random number because you want to create maybe filters that follow different paths depending on that number. There's lots of things possible with it. If you have any questions about math, just let me know in the comments below. And if you want, I also created a cool IntegroMod cheat sheet that includes more things like this that took me quite a while to learn. So if you download it, then I think it will maybe make your IntegroMod life a little bit easier. Okay, I will see you in the next one.